Now, it is my absolute delight to introduce Gohar Dashti, who is a photographer and video artist. She was born in Avaz, a town close to the border between Iran and Iraq. She received an MA in photography from the Fine Art University of Tehran, and she has since focused on social issues with particular references to history and culture in contemporary society. She's participated in several artist residencies, most significantly and most recently at the McDowell Colony in New Hampshire. Many of you are familiar with that wonderful place. She's received scholarships such as the DAAD Award, Visiting Artists 1 Mile 2 Project in Bradford, England, and the International Arts and Artists, well, award, but it's an exchange program, isn't it, in Washington, D.C.? Okay, so both an award and also a participation in an exchange program. She has also held various exhibitions around the world, and her works are in numerous international collections, including the Mori Art Museum in Tokyo, the Museum of Fine Arts Boston, the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art in Kansas City, and the Sackler Museum at Harvard University in Cambridge. Gohar lives and works in Tehran. Please give her a warm welcome.
Thanks to all of you that come today, and a special thanks to museum and museum staff that gave me this opportunity to talk and share about my work. Today, I want to briefly talk about some of my work and some of the series, not the work that you can see in the museum here, and you can see how I think and what's the connection between my work and my background. Because most of my work has a connection to my life and how I grew up and my memories, I wanted to share with you these photos when I was 3 years old, because I was born in Ahvaz and grew up there, and it's the city that war happened between Iran and Iraq. So, Islamic Revolution happened in 1979, and the 1 year after revolution, war started, and it was 8 years. So, and at first, I like to present some documentary photos about war and revolution in Iran that has a connection to my works. This specific photo is from Mr. Azadeh Akhlaghi. It's one of the pieces that is really important for me, that how war come through to your home. And you can see effect of this photo in my other works. Today Life and War Project. When horrific nature of war become normal, it take a surrealistic form. It is a strange moment. The 2 Day Life and War series that I did the project in 2008, I tried to become your storyteller with the narrative that it is still like a figurative painting. whereby each photo represents a pregnant moment in a story. This work is a series, but each work has its own pictorial narrative, dramatize the sense of place and narrative to the single frame. The series Two-Day Life and War emerged from my experiences during the 8 years Iran-Iraq War. This conflict has had a strong symbolic influence on the emotional life of my generation. Although we may be safe with the wall of our home now, the war continues to reach us through the newspaper, television, and internet. This project was my memory about the war time because I was kids and the war happened and the normal life continued. We went to the birthday party, we went to the school, and it's like a normal, we had a normal life, but war always was in your background. And I think it's not a stop for my generation, and we are still worried about the war again in my country. So, and this part, I want to talk really briefly, because I don't have enough time to talk about all my work, but I just want to show Iran Untitled and a Stateless series that you can see three pieces of Iran Untitled in the exhibition here, and it's good to see other work. And also, this body of work has a connection with the documentary photos from refugees across in all of the world. Iran Untitled project, the idea came, I live in Iran. When I was a student, I was in Tehran, and my parents live in another city in Ahvaz. In Mashhad. It's 1,000 kilometers between two cities. And for family reason, I should every week visit them. And I usually go with bus and train and see this landscape. And I thought it's really big country, but why I think I don't have enough space to live. I mean, emotionally and so, in my life. And when I back again to the landscape and I got, yes, it's big. And I think the geography has a connection with the society. And I start to, pack people in one places and shoot them. And this body of work, it doesn't have a very direct message. It is about, my feeling about the life. And the landscape is exactly the landscape that I, traveled between Tehran and Mashhad. Stateless series. Is it another project that has a connection with that? It's a project about the stateless, in like people leaving the airport. It's like when you have to move out, who want to open the arms for you? Who want to say welcome to you? And it's like you lost your identity, and you are waiting for future, and you cannot see the future. And maybe nature could be a mother for you. And I took this series in Gresham Island in Persian Gulf, and because I wanted to try find the landscape is not blind to a specific one country. It could be everywhere. It could be nowhere. And people trying to find a life in the nature. Trying to bring their root, identity. So, and one of my recent work that I have done last year, one part I work in Iran and another part in Maktabul Art Residency. So it's with no people, but has a connection about social issue. I went to Ahvaz, the city that I was born, because I did the research about why, again, a lot of people go out from the city. Now Ahvaz is one of the polluted cities in all of the world, because most of the rivers are completely empty, and the sand come from the river go to the city. And it's a time that the people cannot live there. So, and I went there, and I went to the home that I was born, and I saw the palm, and the palm still was there. A little bit curved, but it still was there. And I got nature has a much more than power of human. Even after a million years, you know, we are not there, but nature stay there. So, and also when people go out, they still have a root in the home that they live. They have, you know, is it the root they related to their identity? And I did the home series. And at the end, I did a very short video about how I make my project, and I'd like to share it with you.
Thank you. Should I do something here? Right, but should I change anything on the screen? No, that's all figured out. All right, good. Azadeh, you'll want it up here. So it's my pleasure to introduce Azadeh Akhlaghi, who was born in Shiraz. She's a graduate of the RMIT University in Melbourne, Australia. Azadeh worked as an assistant director to Abbas Kiarostami, and between 2005 and 2008, while she was working with him, she made a couple of short films that were screened in numerous film festivals, including one at the Berkeley Art Museum in Busan and in Oslo. Since 2009, her interests have shifted to staged photography. And she's going to tell you a lot more about that. Azadeh is a Sovereign Arts Prize finalist, a recipient of the third prize from the Unhabitat Photography Competition in London, and she was awarded the first prize in the Women and Urban Life Competition. Since 2001, Azadeh has participated in numerous art exhibitions in Iran, Turkey, France, India, Australia, England, and the US. Exhibitions that include By an Eyewitness, which was featured at the Obscura Festival in Malaysia in 2015, and Burnt Generation, Contemporary Iranian Photography, that first debuted at the Somerset House in London and is now here. She also exhibited at the Shanghai Biennale in November of 2016. She lives and works between Tehran and Melbourne. Please give her a warm welcome.
Hello, everybody. I'm very glad to be here in Wichita. This is my first time in the US. And I'm so happy to be here today, and thanks to the staff of Ulrich Museum and Wichita University for making this possible. Well, I'm going to talk about my series, which is entitled By an Eyewitness. When the idea of the project started in 2009 after the re-election of Ahmadinejad as the president of Iran again. And I started to think about all these tragic moments of the history of Iran during the recent century, since the constitutional revolution of 1906 till the Islamic Revolution of 1979. The project has 17 images. The first one is about constitutional revolutionaries in Iran in 1908. And the very main figure is this man, Jahangir Khan Surestrafil, who was a journalist. And he died in the day of the bombardment of the parliament of Iran by Russians in 1908. This is how I reconstructed the moment, and this is the real image of these people. And there was this photograph took by a photographer at that day, and this is how I put the photographer in this image, in the very right side of the image. And then I had this man, Colonel Mohammad Taghi Khan Pesyan, who was a pilot and a nationalist in 1921, after the coup d'etat again, which took place by the support of the British in Iran. He died in a tragic way by the order of the Shah, Reza Shah. And then I have this man, Farrukhi Yazdi. He was a poet and a journalist. In 1939, he died in Kress prison in Tehran by injection. They killed him, basically, and that's how they killed him. And I used many references of painting and documentary photographs for my as my references, and this is one of them by Goya, and that's how I use this painting to make this for this reconstruction of the death of this poet of Iran. And okay, this one is about 1953, the first time that the police attacked the students inside a university. This is the Faculty of Engineering of Tehran University. And this incident happened a few months after the coup d'etat of 1953, which took place in the August, when a coup d'etat happened in Iran, and they overthrew Dr. Mossadegh, who nationalized the oil of Iran. And the coup d'etat took place by the CIA and MI6. And this is the how they shoot three students inside the university. And still we celebrate this day as the student day. And this happened at the exact day when Nixon was coming to Iran. And this is the student who is the symbol of this day. He was, you know, shot in the middle of my image. You could see him, and this is how I used again documentary photography to reconstruct my image. Like, for instance, this one is about the civil war in Cyprus. This is Arab Spring in Egypt. I use all these photographs to make, you know, my mise-en-scène. This is Iran Revolution in 1978. Again, same Iran's revolution. And this one. So if you look at my image again, in the very left side hand, I exactly have these two figures. There is one man who is shouting, and I used this in the left side of the image. I basically showed these images to my actors to do the same thing. And you can see this man in my very right side hand of the image. And this one. And this is about from the Green Movement of Iran in 2009, after the re-election of Ahmadinejad. And this one is about a young student who was a part of guerrilla movement in Iran, and she was shot in the streets of Tehran in 1974. And this is how I make my images. Like, basically, I go and act in the place of my actors. And this man is Mirzadeh Eshqi, a poet and a journalist who was assassinated in his home in 1924 after the coup d'etat by the order of the Shah. This is how was he assassinated in his home. And this is how I basically reconstructed the moment. You can see the murderer in the assassinator in the very left side of the image. You can see the gun. And Mirzadeh Eshqi is on the ground, and his lover, Catherine, is there. And in all the images, you can see me as the eyewitness, always with a red scarf. And now I'm in the underground here in the right side hand of the image. And this is the location. And this is how I put all this, you know, I make the storyboard. And this is one of the images that I used as my reference. This is the Kent State shooting in 1970, and I showed this image to this woman here to act. So basically, I collect all these photographs from photojournalism, and I use them in my when I'm doing the shooting. And this is another one which happened in Berlin when the Shah of Iran was visiting Germany in 1967. And they shot this young student, a protester, in Berlin. And this one is about Dr. Arani, a very important figure in the history of Iran. He was a professor at Tehran University. He studied in Germany, and he was killed inside the prison by torture. And this is the moment that his mother came to recognize the corpse of her son, and she could not recognize him because of too much torture, and she said, "This is not my son." That's why they brought another corpse from the prison, and that's why I put that man in the very left side of the image again, to show how they sent another one, because the mother couldn't recognize him. And I used again this image as my reference from Kosovo. I used this image from this mother in Iran in 2010, whose son was a Kurdish young teacher and was executed in Evin prison in Tehran. I used this. All the mothers. And this mother of Sohrab Arabi, a young student who was murdered in the aftermath of presidential election in Tehran in 2009. And it was very interesting because this mother came to my exhibition in Tehran, and when she looked at Dr. Arani's image, who was murdered inside the prison in 1940, she told me that this is me. Arani's mother is me. And I told her, yes, I used your image, and I showed it to my actress to do exactly what you did when you were aware about the death of your son. And this is a son, a very young student, 21 year old, who was murdered. This is another mother whose son was dead inside the prison in 2012. His son was a young blogger. And these are the paintings that I used to reconstruct that image, and famous paintings by Munch. And the last image that I'm going to show you is about this man, Hamid Ashraf, who was a part of guerrilla movement in Tehran in 1976. He was died like this, in this home, with all his friends, and they were all part of this movement. They were killed by the secret police of the Shah inside the house. And this is the house when it was empty, and this is me acting again. And this is him, Hamid Ashraf, and his friends. And the woman that I put in the image is this woman, Azam Ruhi Ahangaran. And these are the images that I used as my references. Like this one is about Iran and Iraq war, and this is with Katy Colbitt's famous painting. And this one. And I think, I don't know if I have enough time to talk more. I do, okay. So I show you one more. And this one is about Furuk Farrukhzad, a very important figure in the women movement in Iran. She had influence on every Iranian girl, basically. She was a poet, and she died very young when she was 32 years old. She was a filmmaker and a poet. And everybody imagined how she died. Because, you know, all my images, there is no photograph available of the moments of their death. So basically, I made all these by collecting data, interviewing people, finding confidential documents, and reading radio reports and newspaper reports of the time to reconstruct the moment. And this is how I imagined how Furuk died, in a car accident like this. And you can see me running towards her in the right side of the image again. And this is the newspaper of that time. This is a real car. And this is how I met the car. You know, you can see the door is very similar. And even the window of the, because her head was pushed towards the window, and I used this image, which is a screenshot from a movie, a video that I found from that time, and I used exactly that to make this window of the car. You know, I put that for the glass of the car. And this is Ayatollah Talaghani, who died in 1979 in a mysterious way, in a suspicious way. And I used this image to make this. So you can see the people of Iran mourning for this Ayatollah who was with the people, died in a suspicious way, only 1 year or 10 months after the revolution. And you can see the people behind the door, behind the windows, and could not come in. And he was called the father of Iran, and that's why I put this little boy looking, gazing like into the camera, into my camera. And that's the only image that I am looking into the camera as well, like the little boy, because I was born in the year of revolution, in 1978, so I could have been like 1 year old when he died. And all these subjects, all these characters that I chose, I could imagine if they wouldn't die at that age, at that time, the history of Iran could have been different. I think that's enough. Thank you.
So Burnt Generation was curated by Fariba Farshad and organized by Photo London. And I know many of you have seen the exhibition, but if you haven't or haven't spent enough time there, please do. The show is up through December 5th. And now we have the good fortune of having two scholars here from the University of Kansas, and I'd like to invite them both to come up onto the stage and join us for the round table. So Dr. Ahmad and Dr. Gerschultz, I really am sort of blinded. I know you're out there. Thank you. Will you guys come up? So Dr. Gerschultz is an assistant professor in the Department of African and African American Studies at the University of Kansas and a 2018 Hans Robert Romer Fellow at the Orient Institute in Beirut. Her research centers on African and Arab articulations of modernism with an emphasis on tapestry. She was an American Council of Learned Societies Fellow in 2016. For the writing of her first book, Decorative Arts of the Tunisian École, Fabrications of Modernism, Gender, and Power. And this is soon to be published, is that correct? From Penn State Press. She has served on the board of AMCA, the Association for Modern and Contemporary Art of the Arab World, Iran, and Turkey, since 2015, and was a subject advisor for the anthology Modern Art in the Arab World, Primary Documents. Thanks for being here. Sure, why not? Dr. Ahmad is currently a lecturer in the Department of Slavic Languages and Literatures at the University of Kansas. He holds a master's in philosophy and Persian literature from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi, and a PhD in Near Eastern Studies from the University of Arizona, Tucson. His research and teaching interests lie in Persian language, Middle Eastern literatures, Indo-Persian culture, and nationalism. His recent publications include Tajik Persian, Readings in History, Culture, and Society, and a post-colonial reading of Simon Denchavar's novels, The Spiritual and the Material Domains in Modern Literature in Iran. He is currently working on a manuscript tentatively entitled Narrative of Nation and Iranian Modernity in Persian Literary Imaginary. He has presented many papers and delivered invited lectures on various literary cultural topics in Iranian studies. Please welcome Dr. Ahmad. Thanks for being here.
Is this working? I think so. It's wonderful to be here tonight, and thank you all for being in the audience. And thank you so much, Gohar and Azadeh, for joining us here in Kansas, and Razi, my colleague. I really enjoyed hearing about your work and your presentation of images. And one of my questions would be to both of you about sort of your own artistic trajectory and genealogy. So if you might elaborate a little bit more about some of your own training or your sources of artistic or intellectual inspiration, and perhaps any other artists or teachers who've been impactful for you.
I studied computer science, so I was going to become an engineer. And then I worked with Abbas Kiarostami as assistant director, and I wanted to become a filmmaker. And I made some short films at that time. And then I focused on, you know, stage photography and that. So I think, you know, what influenced me to become this is, you know, it has a long story. Like when I was a kid, I loved literature and I loved poetry. And, you know, with Iranian people, poetry is in our blood, basically. When you go shopping, people answer you with poetry. It's like that in the streets of Tehran, everybody recite some poems, and everybody knows poetry by heart. So I think the main thing is literature. That's how I'm making these photographs now. Yeah.
So for me,
it's what?
Yeah. For me, in high school, I studied graphic designer. And I had a two-course photography. And that time, photography was really technical. It's, you know, just spend whole day in the dark room. But we, you know, I had a teacher, Miss Soleimani, in a school that talked about photography could be art. And it was the first time something came to my mind, photography is the art. And after that, you know, I studied photography in Tehran Art University, bachelor and master degree. And I had two amazing professors, Bahman Jalali and Mehran Mohajer. Mehran Mohajer is a fine art photographer, and Bahman Jalali, photojournalist. And they're both trying to learn us to, you know, how the photography can have a message. So, yeah, and it's a way that, you know, come through my life. And after that, I went to Berlin for 2 years, and I had a very great professor, Ursula Neugebauer, in University der Kunst. And she learned me as an artist, be open for new experiences. Because my university and my background was very technical university, so, but she opened my mind that do everything that you want. Yeah.
Great, thank you. And so I actually think, Razi, this would be a good time to ask you about perhaps further contextualizing some of the works that we've seen today, both in the exhibition and this evening in the panel, in terms of other forms of literature, film, et cetera, in Iran.
Is it working? Yeah. Well, so I'll keep my answer, I hope, to keep it brief. If I'm going long, then you can raise your hand and I'll stop. Usually I go beyond my time every time I talk, because probably I speak slow. So, well, to contextualize the works that we saw, or actually some of the works that I have printed out here from both of you, these many of these pictures are actually not here in the exhibition. I was fortunate enough to go on your websites and find them. And these are amazing. Truly, these are amazing photographs that tells a lot about a lot of things. So I would say that the discourse about Iran-Iraq war, because this exhibition is about born generation. I can tell more about born generation, whether what it is and what it means to be to different people. But as of now, let me answer your question that you asked. So it's the discourse of Iran-Iraq war. We can say that there are two discourses. One is official discourse that we have, and the other is the non-official discourse. So that is generated by the common people, the common writers, who are not, who do not have either direct approval or support of the state. So the state sponsored this discourse or narrative of Iran-Iraq war that is intertwined with the narrative of the Islamic Revolution itself, because if you can find in history books that, well, the Iran-Iraq war was not the only thing. There was something behind that also in both the countries, like even in Iraq or in Iran. So there were many things going on. So these discourses are intertwined. So this official discourse, they tried to portray this, the whole thing, as something that should be celebrated. For example, the death and destruction, the martyrdom, that is something to be celebrated. That is something that each young person should have this goal to achieve it. There are literatures, paintings, murals. You have that were erected all over the places in major cities. There were short stories, novels that were written that talks about martyrdom and how people can sacrifice their life for the country. But then there is a clause that, well, this country, it's not simply for country. Rather, the projection was sacred defense, the sacred war. So it was not simply a war between two nation states of Iraq and Iran. Rather, it was a sacred war that was being fought by the Iranians against the infidels, who were the attackers, the Saddam Hussein and his army. And the same kind of discourse you see in Iraq also, that was the second Qadisiyya and all. So we don't have to go into that discussion. But to come to the art, like fine arts, there were murals and other paintings that, I'll give you just one example. For example, the dead persons some people have died and their souls flying, happy and flying and going up to the sky, to the heaven. This actually reminds me documentary series that was Rivayat-e Fath. And Rivayat-e Fath, that actually very much, I would call it, romanticizes the whole thing. It talks about how lovely it is to go to war and actually cleanse yourself. It's kind of a mystical experience that you can purify yourself and get closer to God, and finally, probably you, if you are fortunate enough to get martyrdom, and then you can go back to God. So this was one discourse. This is glamorization of the war, if I'm allowed to say that. Maybe it may not be a very appropriate word, but more or less it was romanticized. On the other hand, we have non-state discourse, non-state narrative, where we have novels, short stories, we have films, documentaries, all these that gives you another picture, the other side of the story. And that is the sufferings of the people. That's the loss that people have to suffer. So, for example, Zameen Sukhte by Ahmad Mahmoud, it's about war, it's a war novel. But he does not go take his story only to the forefront or the front line, and he actually talks about the sufferings of the people, what kind of difficulties people are facing. If you read it, you feel like crying. And actually, his own brother had been martyred, and that had greatly affected him, and that was one reason that probably it was coming out from his heart, probably, and he could write that. I talked about Rawayat al-Fath. On the other side, you have a documentary made by Jostaju, Search, Amir al-Nadri. And in that documentary, again, you say you don't see this glorification of death or martyrdom. Rather, you see how people are suffering, how people are dying, what happens to the people who are left behind, these kind of things. So we have two discourses. Here, I would situate, maybe including you both, you may disagree, and once you create a work of art, once it goes to public audience, we are free to interpret in our own way, so you may differ. But I see these pictures as of wars, for example, your picture, that it says a story that, actually it resonates what you said, partly, that life goes on. Okay, so there is a death and destruction, life goes on. But at the same time, at what cost? Okay, it's the suffering, it's the pain that you have suffered. And that's the burned generation, if we go in very specific context, like just like that period, 1973 to 63 to 70 or something. So this generation has suffered a lot, definitely. And the representation that we see here, these, like, for example, a couple in their wedding dress getting a picture in the middle of a desert where they are sitting in a non-functional car, and behind that you have all those things that reminds you of the war. So in the back, there is still a war. Actually, there is a movie, Mim Misle Mother, in which there is a couple who are expecting baby, and finally they go to the doctor and they say that, well, probably the kid is going to have a lot of physical and mental problems, so the husband decides, let's abort, and for the abortion, and the wife decides, no, we are not going to do that. And then she continues, he divorces her. And the reason of those physical deformity or mental retardation that the doctors were predicting was because of the Iran-Iraq war, because she was a nurse and she had been exposed to these chemical warfare. Later on, they find out that, well, the child had some other reasons, genetic reasons, not the chemical warfare. So this, in the film, you have similar kind of resonation. It resonates from here. It's kind of intertextuality you can see here between the works and these kind of movies and even the stories and short stories, these places. So I see this intertextuality there. Well, I hope I answered your question.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
And I did not take much time, I hope.
No, absolutely. Thank you so much. Gohar and Azadeh, do you have anything that you'd like to say in response to this?
Actually, he referred to some amazing reference about war, and I'm really happy to hear that. When you talk about the Rawayat al-Fath, it's the one thing that just I saw in a TV about the war. So every day, as you know, Riwayat Fars was on the TV, and you know, after the cartoon, we just look at the Riwayat Fars. It's like, you know, it's, and we thought it's a lovely war as you talk about it. So, and when I grow up, and I got, okay, we are still, you know, it's like we still have a war. We still worry about the war. It's like my generation grew up in this situation. If something happened, you know, in another world, or as at the meeting with the, between Israel and United States, we are worried about the war. And it's, you know, always in my background. And is it the reason in the two-day life and by project, normal life continue, because you cannot stop your life, but it's like something as in your, you know, behind you. And it's like a normal life, it's still we, you know, we're living like that. And also refer to the Ahmad Mahmoud that, you know, talk about Ahwaz. Even if you haven't seen Ahwaz, you can feel that with the, you know, with the book. So, and yeah, and just I wanted, you know, say that.
So I found it really interesting that many of the photographs in the exhibition actually I found related to Edwige Danticat's conception of creating dangerously. And this is a book at KU that many of us have been reading because it's our common book. And it seems to me quite relevant to this exhibition. And by creating dangerously, Danticat speaks of how artists and audiences take risks as they, quote, create a revolt against silence, end quote. And she writes, quote, all artists, writers among them, have several stories, and one might call them creation myths, that haunt and obsess them, end quote. And hers, you know, she goes on to detail in her book, is an assassination of two Haitian freedom fighters, Marcel Newman and Louis Durin, in 1964, and she didn't witness this event, but it's something that has haunted her and inspired her to write through the length of her career. And so in Burnt Generation and in many of the works that you showed tonight, and particularly you, Azadeh, were confronted with images and with representations of marginalized, displaced peoples, the tortured and the dead. And so I was wondering if you might speak to sort of your own approaches to your subject matter and sort of what it might mean to you as an artist to create dangerously.
Well, as I said, the idea of doing by an eyewitness started in 2009 after the re-election of Ahmadinejad in Iran. When, like, 3 days after, 3 million people came to the streets of Tehran, and they had this silent protest, which took about 8 hours from very early in the morning till the afternoon. The whole streets of Tehran were full of people, and it was all silence. Nobody said anything. We were just walking, and I was one of them. And we thought that if we remain silent, they won't shoot. But they did in the end. And it killed some people at that day. And then this video of this very beautiful young philosophy student, Neda Agha Sultan, became viral because when they shoot her on that day, and there was this man with a camera on his mobile phone, he captured the moment and the video went viral and the whole world watched the video. And then the next day, and the next day, and the next week, and the next month, and the whole year, we continued coming to the street. And, you know, and in the end, nothing happened. Ahmadinejad served as a president until the end, after 4 years. And anyway, I was always thinking during those days that everybody who comes to the street again has watched that video. And they know that they might be shot today. And they're still doing it. They're coming. And many people, it's not just 1 or 10, there are sometimes 10,000, 100,000 people came to the street. And then I thought about, first of all, what happened to you? What do you think in the moment of a revolution when you risk what the only thing that you have, which is life, and you're gonna risk it, and you do it, and we have done it in our history in Middle East for many, many, many years, since the constitutional revolution of 1906, which is one of the first revolutions in the world. It's before the Russian Revolution, after the French Revolution, that Iranian asked for parliament, and they did that. They had this revolution, and they were killed, they died. All these freedom fighters in our history, all these writers, journalists, poets, prime ministers who died in a tragic way, asking and hoping for freedom. And we never had it. We still don't have it. And at the same time, I thought about the power of camera. I was thinking about this girl, Nadara Sultan, because exactly at that day, another girl who I knew was shot in another street. She was beautiful. She was like 22 years old, and everything was very similar to Neda, but there was no camera available at the moment of her death to capture the moment. So nobody knows her, nobody cares about her, but everybody talks about Neda. So that's why I thought about how I could reconstruct these moments of these repeated tragedies of the history of Iran, and when there is no photograph available of the moment, and then how could I raise this question to the mind of not only Iranian, the whole world, why we have such a brutal history and why we are repeating this vicious circle in our history. So it's like that.
And so what have been some of the reactions to your work?
Well, in Iran, during the exhibition, it was very emotional. So many people came to the show, not the gallery goers, normal people, ordinary people, who were friends of these, of my characters, who, some of them were eyewitnesses, that I could not contact them before, you know, when I was doing the research, but they contacted me after they saw the photographs, and they gave me some documents, they gave me their accounts of the moment. And yeah, it was very emotional, lots of cries and hugs during the exhibition. But now, because I did this project like 6 years ago, and then they started to share my images on social media as the real images. So they believe that, many people now, they believe that these are the real images, and because of the censorship, because of, you know, all these, the history that we have, now the images are available. And it was very scary for me, that's because I have to always explain to them. But in the end, I gave up because they don't care. You know, they think they are real. So although I'm in all of them, although the pictures are very, you know, new, because, you know, when, like this image is 1960 something, you know, so it's obvious that this is not the real footage, but they think they are real. So, yeah.
And Gohar, what about some of the responses to your work? And do you consider yourself also to be kind of creating dangerously, taking risks?
Actually, when I work in new series, I show my work in Iran and outside. And in Iran, it's a little bit different. The people has experiences about the war, and so much more understanding about their work. Or even my exhibition in Germany, it was very interesting. Some people, old people, remember about the war and has a connection to my work. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so Gohar, you know, I was wondering in terms of the contemporary art market, you know, sort of what, if you've experienced any pressures, or how you envision your work and how it sort of situates into specific categories that are often placed upon artists by museums and other international venues, such as Islamic art. So for example, I just came from the V&A and saw the finalists for the Jamil Prize, in which artists receive awards for being inspired by contemporary Islamic design. And there's sort of these rigid categories at times for Islamic art or contemporary Middle Eastern art. And I was wondering if you have faced any sort of pressure from the international art market or curatorial efforts, et cetera, if you might speak to that and how your work fits or resists some of these pressures.
Actually, when, you know, I just want to talk about my experiences and how is my work in different museum or gallery. When I produce the artwork, I don't know what happened for this series. It's like, I don't know, maybe it could be everywhere, maybe just one show or two show. Because usually when I produce the artwork after that and show it in Iran, in my gallery, and I have three galleries, one in Milan, one in Boston, one in Tehran. And when I produce a new work, I present a new series in three galleries. And after that, my gallery show my work in the art fair, and some curator come to see the new series and invite me for the festival, Biennale or something. And curator are interested to know more about that. I have five books, they can review my books. So it's like the work, find a way to go up, and I follow my work. And my, especially my new works that is not, unfortunately, I didn't have a time to show that. It's very, abstract. And I made a photogram and sound print. And also the last series is a Polaroid. And, I'm a very experimental artist. So, and I prefer this style, be open and work as, I want. If I want to focus on, Islamic, as you said, or Middle Eastern artists, so is it the face for me? And I really doesn't like that. So I prefer to be free and produce the artwork. I cannot cut my background because, I grew up there, I lived there, is it the country and my work about the social issue, but you can talk about it in a different way. Yeah.
Right. Thank you very much. And so maybe I'll ask a final question. I'm not sure how we're doing on time, but I want to make sure that the audience has time for questions. So sort of speaking of curatorial efforts, the title Burnt Generation that applies to this exhibition, sort of what does that mean to all of you? And Razi started to touch on that as well, but I'd like to hear from all of you with this.
It's a very good question, actually, especially for the audience, English-speaking audience. Well, this burnt generation, it's an English translation of nasle sukhte. And this may mean different thing for different people. In Iran, I guess we were just talking that people don't agree what it means. And who are nasle sukhte? Who are actually burnt generation? I'll first talk about this, but then if we have time, I would like to talk little positive things also about the burnt generation. So the burnt generation here on our flyers here for the burnt generation, this exhibition, we have 1963 to 1963. But really, is it so? How about the people who were in early 20th century? Who, like Constitutional Revolution, you mentioned, Azadeh mentioned, you had pictures also about Constitutional Revolutions. Many people were killed, and their aspirations really, they could not realize their dream. So they were burnt generation, probably. How about the people who perished during the Iron Fist rule of Reza Khan, Reza Shah, or Muhammad Reza Shah? Many of the pictures that we saw here, they were from the Pahlavi period. So different generations can claim that, well, we are actually the burnt generation, okay. But I'll come to the generation that this exhibition is supposed to be, it is about. So that is the generation that is from 1963 to 1979. And I would say that, well, it should include until 1988 at least, because the Iran-Iraq war was continuing and it did affect a lot of people during that time. So this Nasle Sukhte, it's said that it's a lost generation. When we hear this burned generation in English, we feel that, well, a simple meaning would be like a destroyed generation that has been burned down or something. For me, it's not that simple. Okay. For me, I feel that whenever I hear this word or this appellation, Nasle Sukhte, it reminds me of a couple of things, actually a myriad number of things in Persian. For example, there is a very famous idiom, Sukhtano Sakhtan. So there, Sukhtan, you don't burn. It means simply that you try to put up with difficult situation. You face difficult situation stoically. So, and semantically, it takes you, for example, Shahnameh. In Shahnameh, there is a story about Salvash, one of the famous heroes in Shahnameh. And Shahnameh is a national epic of modern Iran. So in that, he has to pass through fire to prove his innocence. And actually, you can relate here that the Iranians were fighting the official discourse that a sacred war and defending their country, and actually they were innocent. So you can relate it there. Then it also semantically, once you start talking about Siavash, it takes you to a mythical creature bird that is in Shahnameh. It's called Simurgh. Simurgh in English, it is translated as phoenix. And phoenix, we all know that it doesn't die. It rises from its own ashes. So this Nasle Sukhte, for me, it's not a destroyed generation. That would be an inappropriate interpretation of Nasle Sukhte. Actually, they have suffered a lot. They have faced losses. They have gone through a lot. But they were actually reborn or fought with the situation, and they are highly successful. For example, two very successful examples, we are right here. We can call them from the Nasle Sukhte. They are from that period. And you have hundreds of examples, successful scientists, artists, writers, and all these people who are highly successful. So it does not mean, for me, Nasle Sukhte means something that's destroyed or something that is gone or something that is wasted. Rather, it's a hardworking generation that has made its own place in this world, that has fought with the difficult situations and actually survived, and life goes on.
Wonderful. Well, thank you. So in the audience, is there a way, do we have microphones going around? I'd like to open it up for questions now. Or does it? Oh, we have lots of mics up here. So are there any questions? Yes, I see a few hands. Sorry, Dean. I'll hurry.
Yeah, to the two artists, are there any difficulties between the government in Tehran and our State Department with you being able to travel back and forth between the two countries?
Well, for me, no, I didn't have problems because I have Australian passport. But with Iranian passport, I think it's impossible to get a visa now.
Um, Thank you so much for coming and sharing your work. Wonderful. I have a question in terms of the context of the work. Of course, we are familiar with Syrian Ashot. She's kind of the reference in the United States, right, work. So I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the context of your work within Iranian contemporary art. That's what I'm thinking of. My question was about the context of your art within Iran, right? Because obviously you're not the only two artists, right, working in Iran. So I was wondering what your references are, how the scene is right now, whether your art is representative of it or not, or.
I understand your question. It's like art is really active in Tehran, and so we have a lot of gallery. How many gallery you said? It's just 180, and every Friday they have an opening and very active, and so and the artists present the work in the gallery. After revolution, university is much more active about the art before that. And, I studied photography in Tehran Art University, bachelor and master degree. And we have a connection with university and, galleries and, art scene foundation, private foundation, not public one. If you want to see how is it in Iran, it's really active. And university is really active. Most of the artists that you can see in the exhibition graduated in Tehran Art University.
A few more hands on this side of the room.
I would like to ask whether you are limited in expressing your feelings in your art. The things that you show in Tehran.
Yeah, of course, we have censorship, we have borders, and but like Gohar and I, we both were born after the revolution, and we grew up in this system, and we know how to, do what we want and not cross the border, at the same time.
Yes.
So yes, of course there are limitations. Like I could not reconstruct so many tragic deaths after the revolution. So that's why I emphasize on all these brutal moments from constitutional revolution till the moment of revolution, because I couldn't do that. I could not live there if I do that. But when for instance, I can talk about this image, Hamid Ashraf, that I showed to you. In this image, which happened in 1976, the police, the people with the army, from the army, I covered them with the clothes from 2009. But it happened in the 70s. And then in the very, very back, I have the clothes of 1953, at the time of the coup d'etat. So basically I put different dress codes in one image from the 1970s, or I put some, pictures, some books in front of this image, and you cannot see it in this, you know, presentation, but this image is very big, and in the gallery you can see that in the print size. And I put the face of Mohammad Mukhtari, who was killed in the 1995, as he was a writer, and it was the serial killings of the writers in the 90s. And I put his face there. And the book was published 20 years after this image. So this is how I'm trying, you know, to put my message for people, but I cannot go and, you know, reconstruct the moment of the death of Mukhtari,
yes.
You know.
I can see that one has to be aware of history and the things that has happened to see the things that are, in French we say, sous-entendu.
Your imagery is so striking, both of you, and your audience here has immediate access to the visual aesthetic, because there seems to be so much layered information that we're familiar with from the heroic tradition of Western painting, and also from the photojournalism tradition. I mean, they're like the iconic moment of the shooting at Kent State. And just looking at this image of the dead man slumped over what appears to be a velvet upholstered chair, it makes me think of Delacroix and this lusciousness combined with horror, and we need to know the exact history to really understand the full content of this moment. But it speaks to us immediately, because all these sources are coming up to grab us. And in your art, this intimacy of the couple who are, they're living their daily life with this this vast sort of tragic buildup of history. The tragedies of humanity seem to be strewn in bones around them. It's just very, very thrilling. And we must say that, yes, photography can be an art form.
Do we have any other questions? All right, we'll wrap it up. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.